Well, yes, ma'am, it is, but that is still my condition.
That's deep. Well, how'd you do it?
We exist in two worlds, one of love and one of hatred, one of blue skies and one of thunder and lightning. Few movies do a better job contrasting these two worlds than Mel Gibson's masterpiece Hacksaw Ridge. Many war films explore the nature of evil during combat, and I've analyzed a handful of them, but Hacksaw Ridge does something very unique. It shows the nature of goodness during combat. Desmond Doss is far from your conventional war movie character. He isn't naive and malleable like Taylor in Platoon, and he never once considers abandoning his morals to become a soldier like Sergeant Barnes or Animal Mother. Desmond Doss knows exactly who he is, or rather, he knows exactly who he wants to be. There are moments in Hacksaw Ridge that have parallels to other war films, which I will discuss, but my main objective for this video is to get to the Christian roots of Desmond's philosophy and try to understand how on earth he's able to live it out, even with bullets whizzing past his head. Understand on a level past just religious fervor. The Desmond that goes to Okinawa belongs to this world. He's a church boy. He likes to take long walks through the forest. He falls in love at first sight. Desmond displays heroic instincts, but he certainly would be the first person you'd expect to keep a calm head in the epicenter of the Pacific Theater. But counter to expectations, the fear of combat is not the most powerful force holding Desmond back. That title belongs to his father, Tom Doss. His father fought in World War I. He endured trench warfare, chemical weapons, the most hellish conditions in the history of humanity. Tom Doss watches many young men in his community, including his sons, enlist in World War II to serve their country, but he doesn't believe they truly know what serving their country actually entails. In one of the most powerful scenes in the movie, Tom tells the story of his friend who used to get all the girls in town because of how good he looked in his uniform, but during the war itself, machine gun fire ripped through his back and his intestines came out the front of his uniform. It is the perfect metaphor of what Tom is afraid of. Young men eager to enlist for the superficial aspects of serving, only to be destroyed physically and/or psychologically by the reality of serving. Tom's fear for his son culminates in another brilliant scene at the burial site of his best friends who are killed in World War I, and it introduces what I think is the most important theme of the entire film.
You know, whatever beliefs you have in your crazy head now, they won't ever play out. It don't work that way. And if by some, I don't know, miracle chance you survive, you won't be given no thanks to God.
Before Tom delivers this important line, he points out to Desmond that during war, you don't have time to consider the moral ramifications of your actions. You can't just sit there and pray for 10 minutes, waiting for a divine enlightenment. You have to be quick and decisive, or you die. Period. To use the words of Sergeant Hartman, it is a hard heart that kills. If your killer instincts are not clean and strong, you will hesitate in the moment of truth. But of course, Desmond doesn't plan on killing, and that is the second part of Tom's point. Everyone around Desmond is going to do what they can to survive and protect their fellow soldiers, on both sides. The other soldiers are not going to respect Desmond's moral framework because they must depend on him to survive, and not carrying a rifle, that's a problem. Now that last line, if by some miracle chance you survive, you won't be giving no thanks to God. That's the key line of the scene, and the meaning is twofold, I think. The first meaning is, even if you physically get home, you'll be tortured psychologically for the rest of your life. And number two, once you witness the darkest evil of human behavior, you won't be thanking the creator of those humans. And I'll return to that specific idea once we get to Okinawa. Even before Desmond can face the enemy, he must endure the hatred of his own countrymen, and I love how quickly Desmond is alienated. He is giving up a peaceful existence with his beautiful wife to protect these men, and they're everything he isn't. He keeps a Bible next to his bed, they keep porn. Desmond's philosophy is predicated on resisting your animal instincts, and the first thing he sees when he enters the barracks is this guy. The Bible says to love the Father before anything else, but the military tells him that the rifle is perhaps the only thing you'll ever love in life. So Desmond is given a simple choice. Conform to what the army expects and face less struggle, or stick true to his beliefs and constantly be humiliated and ridiculed. Desmond chooses the latter. Say what you will about Desmond's beliefs about killing, but you cannot say he doesn't live out Christ's directive to take up your cross and follow me. In the scene where he's beaten up, it's impossible not to connect it to what happens to Pyle in Full Metal Jacket. So why does Pyle break and Desmond doesn't? It's an interesting question, and my short answer is, he who has a why to live can bear almost any how. Desmond is also forced to endure philosophical attacks along with physical ones. Sergeant Howell tells Desmond that he's a coward and his idiotic beliefs will result in the death of women and children. Captain Glover is more gentle and offers a theological argument against Desmond's beliefs, and Desmond simply responds by saying, "There are some questions too big for either of them to answer with perfect confidence." Entire videos could be dedicated to the questions raised in these conversations, but the bottom line is, every angle of attack is used on Desmond's beliefs, but he stays true to them nonetheless. He suffers immensely during this time and even shows signs of cracking, but with the aid of the Bible and a picture of his wife, he bears his cross and makes it to Okinawa. Now, the violence we see in Hacksaw Ridge is some of the most brutal in film history, and the violence has two purposes. According to Mel Gibson, he wanted the violence to show how horrific war truly is, and also to show the strength of Desmond's faith, that he was able to grow his spirituality in hell instead of being reduced to an animal. The animal language is a constant in many war films. In Hacksaw Ridge, right before Desmond gets a taste of combat, a survivor tells his platoon that the Japanese are animals who want to die. And after seeing all these dead pieces of flesh just lying around, rotting away, being eaten by rats, it would be very hard to see the spiritual aspect of human beings. And this is part of the reason that C.S. Lewis lost his faith during World War I. It took the beauty of the English countryside to awaken a belief in the transcendent after seeing horribly smashed men, still moving like half-crushed beetles, to use Lewis's own words. Desmond Doss does not endure a similar decay of faith. After the war concluded, he gave all credit to God. How is this even possible? Well, I think there are two aspects of Desmond's faith that made it strong enough to endure the horrors of war. He could have simply read the Bible, done his best to save his fellow Americans, and then stopped venturing onto the battlefield when nobody expected him to continue. But he goes the extra mile. At one point, Desmond and Smitty are resting at night in a ditch, and Desmond tells him the story of how he once pointed a gun at his father. He didn't pull the trigger physically, but Desmond says, "I killed him in my heart." This is a reference to Christ's teaching in the New Testament. In the Old Testament, if you followed the commandments, you were good. But when Jesus came, he said that was not going to be enough anymore. You can do something in your heart, but not actually do it. And I think this makes sense, although it's tricky. If you fixate on killing someone, you visualize it, you fantasize about it, but you don't actually do it because you know you'll be thrown in prison, your soul is not in better shape than the person who kills someone else out of rage. Desmond believes that the only way to stay true to his faith is to keep even the thought of committing sins out of his mind. He may pick up a rifle in Okinawa and kill to protect innocence, but perhaps that would open the door to violent thoughts when the war is over. And I don't think that's an unreasonable fear. Of course, if every American soldier thought that way, I'd be speaking either Japanese or German right now, but it's an interesting perspective to consider. In that same scene, Smitty tells Desmond that the rifle won't bite, and Desmond says, "The rifle will bite, look around you." I think that connects to the previous idea. If you get too comfortable with a rifle and how it can be used to protect instead of destroy, you'll forget that its only function is to kill, and a justifiable killing today could turn into something more sinister down the road. Revolutions are a good example of this potential problem. At first, many revolutionaries start by killing the quote-unquote bad people, the people that are holding the rest of society down. But heads continue to roll after those bad people are done away with. And there are many factors to that trend, but individuals becoming numb to killing and violence has to be one of them. The other way Desmond is able to hold off the demons of war is by not adopting a cruel attitude towards the Japanese. He instead decides to rescue enemy soldiers and even make their deaths less painful. On a human level, I just cannot imagine doing something like this. Think back to the end of Full Metal Jacket when Joker decides to end the enemy sniper's suffering. In that situation, the fight was over. Joker had a chance to think through his options and the implications of his options, and still, it was extremely difficult for Joker to make what I think was the right decision. In Desmond's case, he's running all over the battlefield, stepping over dead Americans, and he instinctually decides to reduce the suffering of those who would brutally murder him if given the chance. Just think about how insane that is. And the idea comes from Matthew chapter 5, and I think it's worth reading the biblical passage that inspires Desmond to do this. You have heard that it was said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy. But I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you, that you may be children of your Father in heaven. He causes his sun to rise on the evil and the good, and sends rain on the righteous and the unrighteous. If you love those who love you, what reward will you get? Are not even the tax collectors doing that? And if you greet only your own people, what are you doing more than others? Do not even pagans do that? Be perfect, therefore, as your heavenly Father is perfect. The beauty of that passage never ceases to amaze. But think about how difficult following that command is in civilian life. Go on Twitter for 5 minutes and you'll see how hard it is. Desmond Doss was able to follow that directive during one of the bloodiest battles in human history. It's hard to comprehend. Up until an injury takes Desmond out of battle, he endures everything thrown at him in order to fulfill the mission he believed God sent him on. His entire body becomes covered in mud and blood, but the light inside him never goes out. And for as strong as Desmond is, he's only human. When he finally comes off the cliff, his experiences have had a severe effect on his soul, and Mel Gibson includes this shot right here, very similar to the one in the Hurt Locker, to symbolize the evil Doss has had to witness and overcome. In this context, it sort of feels like a spiritual cleansing, or purification. After realizing Desmond's strength and courage, the other soldiers understandably start to buy into his connection to God. Captain Glover tells Desmond that they don't believe the way you do, but they believe so much in how you believe. Such a wonderful line, it speaks to the power of what Desmond did at Hacksaw Ridge. The movie ends beautifully. The way Desmond asks for his Bible as they take him off the battlefield says everything about who this man is. And on a personal note, when I listen to people say things like, religion is a plague, we need to root it out of society in favor of a science-based rationality, what was rational about what Desmond Doss did? Could he have done what he did without a belief in a loving and personal God? I very much doubt it. And when Desmond returned home after seeing the absolute worst the world has to offer, he gave thanks to God, proving his father's prediction wrong. And perhaps that's because for as horrible as things were in Okinawa, light still shined in the darkness, and the darkness did not overcome it. And I think for Desmond, the fulfillment of that biblical promise, a promise of hope, was more than enough to keep his faith strong. There is so much to talk about when it comes to Hacksaw Ridge, and I might make a second video discussing another idea Mel Gibson brings up in the future, but that is where I'm going to stop for today, guys. Desmond Doss, a truly remarkable man. And it makes me so happy that a director was able to do right by his story. Mel Gibson is probably the only director with enough respect for Desmond's beliefs to actually pull it off. And if you enjoyed this video, remember to like and subscribe on your way out. I also have a playlist here where I discuss other incredible war films, a couple of which I mentioned in this video. Thank you so much for stopping by. It means a lot to me. Have a fantastic rest of your day. I will talk to you soon.